Hi, everybody. Can people at the back hear me? All right, yeah, good, wonderful. This is going to be slightly different from the papers this morning in that when I read the word inclusivity, I wasn't thinking specifically about people with disability and accessibility issues, but more of a general, how can we be generally inclusive? How can we get more people, whether they are archaeologists themselves or whether they're engaging with archaeology, and how can we be more inclusive in this? Feel free, obviously you will anyways, but feel free to tweet while I'm doing this. There's an opportunity to ask questions and discuss, but if there's something that you take offense with that I say and you don't want to say it to my face, feel free to put it on Twitter and then I'll just read it later. That's fine. I'm going to be deliberately argumentative, maybe, and that's in the hope that I can get some people to discuss. So I'm going really far to one extreme, and I'm aware of that, so hopefully that'll be okay. So my presentation is largely on engaging within academia, but obviously if you've read my abstract, you'll know that if we do this better, it has other outcomes that go beyond academia. I've given an alternative title, which this I think is really, really important. And another one. So it's deliberately maybe controversial, but I don't engage with boring presentations. I might be giving one. You can decide once I'm done. So I want to make it very clear that this presentation is based on my opinions, and it's not everything else. I haven't looked at the literature. I'll be very upfront about that. I haven't looked at the literature on this engagement stuff. It's very anecdotal, and what I'm saying is what I think. The only way that I could bring myself to get up here and talk to you about this, because what right do I have to tell you how I think things should be done better in academia, is because I do a lot of things differently, and it seems to work, and people seem to like it, so maybe if I share what I do with you, you might like it, you might not, but if you do, then maybe you'll start doing it too, and it will have those effects. So this, I think, is what is going to connect all of the papers in this session. So hopefully the ones from this morning, even though they were specifically about dyslexia and about autism and archaeology, there's this sense of how we go about teaching people, whether that's in engagement or whether it's in academia. Some of you might recognize this definition as this word, which first, for me, when I entered a session called Inclusivity and Pedagogy, my first thought was that if we want to be more inclusive, we need to stop using words like pedagogy. I Googled it before I sent off my abstract, just to make sure that I knew what it meant. I don't know if anybody Googled it before they came to the session, just to make sure that you knew what we were going to be talking about. And this is the key theme in what I want to talk to you about, and it's really at its base, it's communication, and it's communicating our ideas, it's communicating what archaeology is, it's communicating what our research is, it's all of these things. So I think there'll probably be overlap in other sessions, certainly there'll be overlap in the social community public archaeology sessions, there'll be overlaps with this afternoon sessions and students in archaeology, but hopefully you'll be able to take something from this. So, how many of you have been to an archaeology conference? Thank you. Good, yes, wonderful, we're all on the same page. How many of you have ever had something go over your head? Fantastic. How many of you have been to a conference where somebody's given a presentation and you just sort of zoned out, read another paper, looked around on Twitter, you know? How many of you have been to a conference where you've gone into the poster room during the break and just sort of went, a lot of words on that poster, I'm just sort of skim around, yeah. Archaeological conferences in general, I think are a really good way to see some of the broader issues that we have in academia. And these are largely to do with communication, but I think that extends to engagement. Why do we come to conferences to engage people with our ideas at its very base and do it in the most mind-numbingly boring way so that people zone out? I just don't get it. So I started to try and do something differently. And I'll preface this by saying I hate case studies. I really, really hate case studies, but I'm now going to present a case study. And it's an example of a poster that I gave at a conference. I had specific motivations for giving this poster in this format, which I could go on at length, but they are mostly twofold. One, it was practicalities. When I made this poster, I was working on site in the field, and I didn't have access to electricity or a laptop often, so I had to find a way to go about making this poster so it would be ready for the conference. And the second is that I didn't want people to skim my poster. I presented this poster at an osteoarchaeology conference, which is already a highly specialized discipline within archaeology, and within that sub-discipline, I'm even more specialized in that I cover a topic called demography, which very few people are interested in, and I wanted people to know about my research. I wanted them to understand what I'm doing my PhD on so that it has a purpose. So I thought, if I can do something memorable, then people who don't know anything about the subject will leave knowing what it's about, and people who are interested in the specifics can then ask me more questions. And I thought that would be a good way to do it. So I'm just going to show you some stills and that of the poster to give you a sense of what it was like. So if you didn't have a chance to see it, then you can see some bits of it now. And I deliberately used what I would say are tactics we use in outreach and engagement that many people are starting to learn for interacting with members of the general public, and I used them in my conference poster. So. I'll just go off piste. This accessibility, I'll come back to. But it's important. I might be saying things about academia. I might be using the word archaeology, but it's really what Katie said in her presentation. It's just best practice for life in everything. So they sort of go hand in hand. So the first thing was first is I'm big into social media. I really like it, so I gave my poster its own hashtag so that if people were talking about it, I could find what they were saying. And this has been really useful when putting together this presentation, even though it doesn't look like I put it together, finding the things that people said about it, because I can now go back and find that information however many months after the fact. So this is what the poster looks like. So this is, obviously that's way too small for you to read, but that's just so you get a general sense of the visual of the poster. So it's done in separate panels. It's very unlike your typical conference poster. So this is a close-up of a small section of it. So you might be able to tell that it's actually in comic form. There's a combination of those things. So I used conversational language. I said, stuff it with academic jargon and just, you know, wrote the poster like I would talk to somebody. I used illustrations. This is one of my favorites. Some of the illustrations were to demonstrate something deliberate. Others were just because they related to the text, so they gave you something interesting to look at. I used humor, so I don't know if you can see this, but the little guy at the bottom is saying, hey, look, that's my other eye, because it's the X's from the graph. It's a poster all about the play, so it's quite a dark topic, so trying to lighten things up and keep people interested was important to me. I used interactivity, so I had flappy panels that you can open and shut, and these were all used mostly for lifting things off, so undercovering the mass graves and things like that. And I also actively encouraged people to engage with me. I had that little arrow could be moved, so depending where I was standing, because I didn't know what the room was going to be like. I told people to come talk to me, but I also said, if I wasn't there, I want you to get in touch with me. I put, obviously, social media because I use it, but I know other people don't, so there's the more traditional email. So if other people want to email me, then they can still get in touch. So, I need to be really, really clear about this. This poster was a massive risk. It was so far into left field that I knew some people would probably hate it. I thought there was the potential for me to be ridiculed, to people not to take my professional integrity seriously, that I was maybe a bad academic. And so that was always there, but I was going to do it anyways, because, you know, I don't know why, maybe because I don't care what other people think of me. But the nice thing is, it was really, really, really well received. So these are some of the things, the key word that came up again and again, and this is in conversations, overheard by other people at the conference. I put cute in the biggest letters because that's what everybody wants their conference poster to be described as, right? Everybody wants it to be cute. But it was generally the sense that people gave me was that they liked that it was different. They used the word engaged a lot. They said it was really engaging. And I think that is really important, that we take these risks, and obviously we're up for it in academia. We're up for something different. We're up for something slightly unusual. And it makes things more accessible. And there's the link back to what we're talking about. It makes things more accessible, and if things are more accessible, then we include more people. This is another thing that I'm going to read. So I got comments from people at the conferences, and I'm being very selective. It's very difficult, I found it very difficult to put this presentation together without it being a massive humble brag about, look at how awesome this poster is, and people said really great things about me. So you can just go read them for yourself because they're there. But people said, I liked the non-standard poster format. It was like reading a story. I liked the fact that it was inventive and fun, and because of this, it engaged you more and drew you in. The pictures were cute, but you got across a complicated concept really, really well. This is a comment from a judge, and I'll come back to that. He said, I think your presentation was what put you ahead of the field. However, good presentation won't get you very far if you have poor content. And I personally found your negative results, so I was presenting the fact that my PhD doesn't work, were really interesting. Many people with negative results don't make as much of an effort to explore the implications, and that judge particularly liked what I was talking about in the poster, so not just the way I did it. Another important thing was that not everybody agreed with the content of my poster, but they said that they did like the fact that it got them thinking. So many posters present dry data and don't require any deeper thinking. And I think that's something that a lot of people resonate with. On Twitter at the conference, somebody else said, this is a great poster, everyone go read it. And then after the conference, I received emails from people, people saying things beyond, I liked your poster, but people talking to me about my research, people wanting to use my methodology, people wanting to write papers. So it has the academic benefit. However, this is what came up. There is this key balance between content and presentation. Many people have tried to do similar things at conferences in the past, and this was brought up at that conference in particular. But you still need to have the academic content. You still need to have data, you still need to have the research, we need to have all of this. It's just that it can be presented in different ways. And I think this is important if we're talking about including people and keeping them within archaeology. It's maybe changing the way that we present all of this academic research and all of this academic data. And this is whether you're at a conference, whether you're teaching in the classroom, whether you're teaching in the field. I think this is really important. Academics have shown that they're open to it. I won 2 poster prizes out of 2 conferences that I brought my poster to. I don't know if there could have been more, we don't know. But this shows me that obviously people are up for this. People are interested in receiving information in a slightly different format, and they're interested in engaging with archaeological research in maybe the non-traditional, non-academic way. But then what happened is I digitized it. So this is a screenshot of my blog. You should all go read it because it's awesome. And then, so this went up at the end of September. It's been viewed over 25,000 times. That goes up every day by a couple hundred. This poster has had impact far beyond that academic conference. People have dissected this poster, and you can go read that if you want, where they've broken it down far better than I ever could about why they think this has worked. But clearly it's having something that other things don't have. I don't know if it's the most read conference poster ever. I've tried to get facts and figures on that from Figshare, but it's very difficult. Figshare is a site where you can put up conference posters. But it was very, very well received. And I got comments from people online, and I'm going to read some of these for you. Now, some of this, as I said, so it's been dissected by people. I did get comments from other academics once it was put online, obviously. And a lot of them said the same thing, either, oh, it's a really different poster, I quite like it, or you manage something really special here, presenting heavy-duty research, a tricky concept, in a way that's educational, entertaining, aesthetically pleasing, and comprehensible to the layperson, but this was the key for me, still interesting to a specialist. I also got comments from people who were not academics. Why can't more academics present their research through interactive posters? I enjoyed the homemade appearance. There's no need for computers or fancy technology. And I think if we're talking about inclusivity, some people might not be digitally literate, and they might find engaging with academics in certain ways more difficult than others. Lots of people saying, not just very interesting, but also accessible. So these people recognize the fact that they were able to access the information that was in the poster that they might not have otherwise been able to get. Some people said, this is an awesome poster, walking you through how real science is done in an entertaining and informative way. And I think I think what people say for me, I was very glad that the academic community engaged with this poster, but I didn't expect members of the non-academic community to engage with it the way they did. And I really liked that somebody said, I want all of history and science explained to me in this format, and they're just going to wait right there while the internet works on that for them. This, I think, is really important. Communicating to people is a skill. It's possibly one that I'm not demonstrating very well because this is what I'm going to call a very fluid talk, and I'm just explaining what I think to you. But it's just as much as a skill as communicating in an academic way. This is something that people need to learn. Lots of people are starting to learn it because they're interested in engaging in public archaeology, so they're learning how to do outreach. But there's no reason why we can't take those skills and apply them within our own communities. And I think it's really important that people learn these skills, how to communicate in different ways. For me, I try to think about how people engage at conferences. I try to think about how I engage with information best and then say, you know, if somebody's going to sit in front of me and give a dry presentation, I'm going to zone out, so I'm going to do my best to do something that's not dry so that people don't zone out. And I think just simple things like that, how you engage with information and then try and apply that. There is, of course, a place for the academic, for the jargon. My poster included subject-specific language, but I explained it. If everything is flashy, funny, you know, something different, then nothing's different and it doesn't stand out. If everybody had a comic poster at that conference, nobody would have thought mine was different. So I think there's a balance between risk-taking, doing something different, but making sure that we're still focused on the academic content and what we're doing. So one of the things I want to say, oh, so this isn't a competition, but it kind of is a competition sometimes because I won some prizes. So this quote says a lot, I think, as to what we're dealing with. If we're trying to make archaeology inclusive and academia inclusive, it's super easy to grasp, even though I'm sure the actual research would be completely inexplicable to me. That poster was the actual research, but they still think that somehow it's been made different. It's been made something that they can understand. And if people think that they can't do that kind of research, then they're never going to get involved in academia. And we're never going to get people to stay if they think that it's something that other people do, as opposed to that's just what it is. We're not all super intelligent individuals. We're just people who have learned the skills how to research and how to do archaeology. I didn't want to end on a downer. So the highest compliment for me was that somebody said it reminds them of Magic School Bus. If you're not from North America, some of you may know it, but this is the highest compliment that somebody who grew up in North America in the 80s can receive. They did have an archaeology episode. And you can see the poster here, so you can have a look at it in detail. I hope that gives you a sense of where I'm coming at it from. I'm hoping that what comes out of me spewing my thoughts on engaging with academics does is that we start to talk to each other. So if you have questions, then ask me questions. If you have questions not about this, I was saying earlier that I haven't specifically talked about disability, but I have lots of views on accessibility in academia, and you can ask me about those as well. But I think the key point, if you want to have a key point from this presentation, is that we can engage each other better. And if we want to have any chance of engaging anybody else with academia or with archaeology, we need to start by doing it with each other. Because if I can't communicate to you why archaeology is fantastic and you should stay and do it, there's no chance that other people are going to think that they can get involved and that they can do it and that it's something for them. So, yes, I'll leave that up so that people can have a look at it.
That was like 20 minutes on the nail. That's really good. Because I'm sure there will be some questions. Or not.
Yes.
Oh. There's no questions, and then you feel miserable. I loved the presentation, and I think it's really engaging. But I think that is that you mentioned this skill. I think that there's two things in there. One, which is that you can teach it, and we don't teach it. But the other, which is that some people are better at it than others. And I think you have to acknowledge that you have a skill that you might be able to share with other people and inspire other people to develop their own, but also to take your own strength in that. I think that's something that we often forget when if someone presented a mathematically complex argument, it wouldn't necessarily say, well, this is just a skill and everybody can learn it. You know what I mean? There's something there that is your strength as well. So I just wanted to make that point.
No, I think that's a good point. And I think I probably glossed over the slide that said this is not a competition. And I think that's one of the things that I think is really important, that although I've gone very far to the extreme in how I'm trying to engage people, but there are easy things, small things that people can do, small changes that people can make to acquire the skills. And the biggest for me is language. It's how we communicate the words that we use, and that's something that has come up a lot at a lot of tag sessions, whether or not it's being said out loud or it's just being done through subtweets, people saying these words are confusing or we're not all talking about the same thing, and I think even just simplifying that is a big step, but we need to actively do that.
But I think you're right as well that it is exclusive, and I think it is sometimes deliberately exclusive. It was many years ago now, in fairness, but I went to a conference where, it was in Ireland, and the National Museum had recently changed its policy about deposition in a way that had made most archaeologists very angry. And this person was coming to speak from the National Museum to the main body of archaeologists. So I was expecting a bloodbath, and he gave a paper which was literally photograph after photograph of their new filing cabinets. And it was so incredibly boring that by the time the paper was over, there were no questions. He had no criticism come back at all because he had successfully blocked all communication through being boring. And I think that sometimes it's a deliberate strategy.
I think what Alison does really well is that use of visuals. So I have an A-level in chemistry, and I've never got isotope analysis. But about a week ago, I sat through a lecture by Dr. Alistair Piper from Southampton, and he used very strong visuals to explain how isotope analysis worked, and I got it like that. So that's what I really like about your work, is the language is there, but I can engage with it because I read the pictures really well. I'm sure that's true for a lot of people as well.
I wonder what your thoughts are on how you might transfer that to an actual paper. Like, making it... I know that there's a community out there that looked at making academic texts accessible to the public, so... And for academics as well, crossing that bridge, and I wonder what your thoughts are on how that might be achieved, because I agree you need to change language, but realistically, you can't use cute images in a slightly more serious text, surely.
I would say why not, but that's just me. After I presented this and once it went online, I had somebody say to me, are you going to submit your PhD thesis in comic form? If I hadn't already written a significant portion of it, I would very seriously consider it if my university would stomach that concept. And there are people doing that. And I think if we don't like the way things are being done, I'm not saying that I'm going to overthrow the academic system, but I'm going to try. I'm going to do my bit to change what I think doesn't work. And I don't like dry academic papers, so I try not to write them. And I encourage other people to do the same. The use of comics, and that specifically, is a really interesting one because people engage with comics. People love comics. And there was a really good paper at SAA the other week, when you can see that poster online, about using comics specifically to communicate archaeology because the visuals, as you said, the visuals work really well because we are already a very visual subject. But I don't see why we can't just change what we put in journals, what journals are. Why not?
Just a comment. There is a archaeology PhD done in the 1990s, maybe early aughts, that was a comic. He does, I'm probably going to misquote this, shovel bum comics. So he turned in his entire PhD thesis as a shovel bum, like in the style of a shovel bum comics, and got a PhD out of it. So there is precedence to do a PhD in comics and archaeology.
That will depend on the academics and your examiners, because I've just experienced a viva which was utterly hell, and part of the issue they had with the way I laid out my data is it was all described as anecdotal and fluffy, and I couldn't express it in any other way, so I've now got to completely rewrite my PhD according to their formula, and that damn well hurts. It really, really hurts because it doesn't. I was also, because of the viva, diagnosed with dyspraxia, and I'm now being looked at for Asperger's as well. So I'm like,
There's a very common link. It's the other way around. Half of people who've got Asperger's, high functioning ASD, do have dyspraxia. So that's interesting because I don't have autism, but I do have dyspraxia, so I don't understand how that overlaps, and you do tend to think things through in a different sort of way. But I think when you're communicating with wider audience on a sort of inclusivity basis, actually sometimes it helps because they're probably more likely to engage in your ideas.
I think I find when I put my research, I presented yesterday, and when I present my research in the way that I want to do it and explain it how I want to explain it, people engage with it more. And when I tried to put it into the academic format that the humanities at Edinburgh University would like a PhD to be, that's where I have difficulties, because this was actually kind of explained, sort of told to me when I was digging, is I do a stream of consciousness when I'm digging. And it caused great hilarity on site because I'm down a tube and I'm talking to my skeleton. And I'm talking
You mean there are people who don't talk to their skeletons? That worries me more.
Weird not to. I even gave them a name. But when it I've actually talked to Lindy Crew, who was my field supervisor, and when she said that when it came to me writing the report, she said it was the clearest, most detailed report because I'd gone through it in my, it's just the way I process things incredibly slowly. So reading is difficult, but I'm not dyslexic. It's because of the dyspraxia it causes. So I've got to the stage where I'm almost 49 and I've spent my entire life avoiding things.
I think, and that comes through to like what Doug was saying this morning, we're seeing a lot of younger people getting having conditions diagnosed at a young age because people are more aware of them. And okay, if you are older, it might have taken a longer time to get that diagnosis. You might have been attracted to the profession because you do have those particular traits, even. So it's kind of how we sort it out for the generation that are coming through, so they don't experience that type of difficulty.
I think probably when I was going, I did my undergraduate, I did my master's by research, and I've done an eternity on a PhD. And because I've worked with the same academics, they know me as a person. They're not necessarily looking for triggers. And I think, and even my supervisor was saying, good grief, if we'd known this at the time, we would have done it entirely differently. That's the same can be said. I think particularly for mature students who possibly have these conditions, I think more needs to be done in terms of when you're going through the process of people being aware of what these triggers are. I think your post is brilliant. I absolutely love it. I did something similar. I was put in a competition. I came up last because they said, oh, we don't think you did enough work. But I did have two people who said, you presented a poster. What you said was clear, concise, and made sense. But because it was not full of words and large chunks of dialogue, people were turning around saying, oh, we don't think you did enough work on that.
Yeah. I think there's a few interesting points that come out of a lot of us, and one of them is there is an element in that poster that I did play the game a bit, because I knew that even though that poster was a risk, there were still elements of a traditional academic conference poster. I had statistics in that poster and things that I included, you know, things that people were expecting to see, and whether or not I can be totally anarchist and sort of flip the academic conference table, I think it sort of needs to be a bit at a time and convince people to come along with you. But I think the other thing you were talking about is really important. As in general, I think there's a wide understanding that academia sucks at being accessible. It's got to be one of the worst areas, and we are maybe the people who should be the most aware of it, and we do terrible at it. And archaeology as a subject isn't much better at being accessible. And I think it's a difficult conversation because there are I've had a discussion with somebody about this already at TAG, but there are people like me who will be very open about my personal experiences, and I will go up to people and say, you need to do this to make it more accessible. But people shouldn't have to do that, and you shouldn't have to put the onus on the people who need things to be made accessible to do it. We should just be doing it already. And until we start to get better at it, people will not be included, and they'll feel like it's not for them. I don't really have any answers other than saying it's a problem, and we need to start talking about it.
I think there's another question.
Yes.
Kind of a response to what you're saying there is, I think that academia is often very deliberately inaccessible, because that is considered to be part of what being academic is. You know, the idea that we are doing something that other people can't do. You know, the whole way that selection is made for entry to academia, the whole idea of selection. All about saying, this is the brightest group of people, and we're going to speak to each other. And then we turn around and say, well, no, actually, we should tell other people about this wonderful stuff we do. But it's still like this we that's really, really strong. And it's interesting the point you make about that, because I think everybody knows that and it behaves that way. And archaeology, with its aspirations, even people who aren't academics in archaeology, who have completely left academia, still have an aspiration in many cases for academia or for academic kudos to come to them. You know, and we still use publication venues as one of the things, you know, a publication of an archaeological site that is academic publication is considered to be better than a published publication, even if the excavation wasn't carried out for academic purpose in the first place. So we still constantly aspire to that model, and we are infected by that lack of accessibility.
I was actually told at master's level that I shouldn't need any more help of any description, because I must have had plenty of help by now, and I should be over it. So that kind of shows academic thinking on disability. Yeah, sorry.
Also, to bring it back to the dyslexia, I have dyslexia and I understand everything that's been discussed, like read academic text, but my grammar is appalling. I struggle to write academic text, but it doesn't mean that I understand it less differently. It's just my output is different from my input. And that's quite a unique way to output that.
Yeah, I think there's actually two things in this with them. And there is a reason for using academic speech for certain things, to work certain things out. But there's a sort of difference sometimes where we don't distinguish between using it to actually work stuff out and it is sort of a status symbol. It's like people who want to have a doctorate going to a doctorate so they can get themselves some status rather than going for it because they actually want to learn something.
Yeah, I really wish that I hadn't decided to get a PhD just to be doctor.
It's like military uniforms, you know, people who like that kind of chic or sports stuff, even if they didn't do sports, they still wear all the sports gear.
I think there's definitely a sense of putting yourself out there in a vulnerable place if you choose to communicate using non-academic language. And whether or not people view your research as less important or less significant because it doesn't have big words in it, I think that's up to them, but I'm very sick and tired of reading academic articles with, you know, dictionary.com on my screen so that I can parse the language in the first paragraph to understand what the paper's about. But I think that's a reflection of sort of a wider issue. And it comes back to what Sarah said. I mean, people engage with archaeology in many different ways. Whether or not we want everybody to be an academic is one thing, or whether or not we just need to start valuing that there are other things that are worthwhile that aren't academia.
I always thought that having to use academic language, or like what I call dense language, was almost a way of me demonstrating that I'm part of the group, and sort of having sort of be able to demonstrate that I'm not there, and that's how I've always done it. And I mean, especially presentations and stuff, but I would speak if I can really speak normally, and it's not how I talk at all. But I was always very, very conscious of trying to build and have people seeing that. Well, so I really struggled to do it. I'll be quite surprised when I get
back. Yeah, I think you need to have a strong personality, which I have, to sometimes do things differently, because I know that there are people who don't like the way I present academic information, but I think what I do is important, and that's enough for me. Whether as long as somebody's getting something from it, then I think I've achieved something. Whether or not I ever end up in an academic position is something that I've had to be very conscious of, because if I don't do things in the traditional academic way, then unless academia changes by the time I finish my PhD in 6 months, people might not necessarily want to hire me. So, you know, swings and roundabouts.
I think being explicit in all work, academic or otherwise, is essential to clearly express your own ideas and what you're presenting, why you think that. And I think my opinion of academic language is, you know, it's very often third person, so you're removing yourself from the ideas that you're presenting. I think that creates real barriers to being explicit, which I think is so important.
That poster, there was one really interesting thing on that poster for me that was a very conscious decision, is that I used the word I in that poster, and I was very tempted to use the word we, because a lot of people, especially female academics, will use the word we did this, our researchers this, when they've done the research themselves, because it distances them somewhat from any repercussions that might happen. And I did that research by myself, and it was a very deliberate choice for me to say, I did this, my research has shown this. I think there are sometimes issues with imposter, just goes so broad into imposter syndrome and insecurity as to whether or not, and using third person language is a way of sort of putting your ideas out there without actually having to say, this is my idea, so if you have a problem with it, don't get mad at me. So, yeah.
I think also when you start expressing things in the first person, people then accuse you of it's just being your opinion. And this is where it comes to it's anecdotal, it's fluffy, because you choose to talk about your own experience of doing the research, or it's your research, it's your idea. But you're not allowed to own it. You're not allowed to say this is me, this is how I'm thinking, this is why I think what I think. It's like, well, no, you can't say that, because that's an opinion. It doesn't matter how much data you have to back it up, it's still just your opinion. Yes, I agree. It becomes it's disengaged, and you just become very amorphous.
Yeah. I'm probably eating into everybody else's time. So shall I go sit and then?
Yeah, it's okay because we have.